Hello everyone, and thank you very much for inviting me here today for this session. I work with Syngenta, and Syngenta I think is a company which most of you must be knowing about. It's an agribusiness company, a global company with about $15 of business across 90 countries. Lots and lots of focus on technology, and lots and lots and lots of focus on farmers. I head the food security group in Syngenta, and this is a very new group. By new, I mean about 3 years. And it's a part of a new strategy which Syngenta has set for itself in 2011. And that strategy goes really well beyond selling of crop protection chemicals and seeds only. It's about solutions and solutions to different segments of farmers. I've been with Syngenta for about 10 years, but in the agribusiness area for 15 years, but I have been a business person for most of the time except the last 3 years. I can tell you that running a project is far more difficult than running a business. So I do projects now, and I'm going to talk about a case study which we've done. Before that, just a couple of slides on what Syngenta is doing now, and this is the new Syngenta ambition and the new strategy. As you can see over there, it's not, as I said, about only sales. It's really about providing farm solutions. But those farm solutions which are very, very sustainable, so there is a huge focus on scarce resources and on, you know, all of the environmental factors. And it's not just that, it's also about the globe, the economy over there, the communities, and the impact on the community of whatever we are doing, including women. So it's about sustainable agriculture, but it's about growing productivity in this environment. Very recently we launched what we call our Good Growth Plan, and the Good Growth Plan is very, very competitive. It involves a lot of what I just said. It's about making sure that farmers get more productivity. It's about more diversity, less of degradation. And it's also about health and safety. And we've sort of looked at different segments where we say that, okay, there are developed farmers, the business focuses a lot on them, but their productivity is also still below average, particularly if you look at the world as a whole, particularly if you look at Asia-Pacific and African countries. If you look in terms of the smallholder farms, they are way behind, so there has to be a special focus on them. And of course, there's the aspect of safety and also of best practices in agriculture. There is a three-pronged kind of strategy that we follow. The first one is about integrated solutions, which means that we don't only talk about our products and our solutions. We talk about also mechanization, irrigation, fertilization, and all of those things which are so important to get the highest possible productivity. So in that, we require partners, and we look to bring in more partners which, who are complementary to what we can give. The second bit is, of course, value-added produce, and we've heard a lot about value chain companies' participation. But what's important is that the farmer needs to produce to what the value chain needs. There is no point in bringing in a value chain company, and there's a difference between what the farmer's offering and what they really need. In some of our projects, which I won't be speaking about here because there are many, many projects that we do, we are developing a special tomato variety for Unilever because that's what they need. And, you know, there are so many traits that are required. So that's very important. So breeding, focused kind of breeding is very, very important, and that's what we are doing. And the last one, and that's the project which I will now talk about, that's really about approaches, because as we heard since the morning, it's not about solutions, it's about how to deliver them. How do you actually get to that farmer, and then how do you from there get to millions of farmers and make sure that what you're doing is benefiting a lot of more companies. So we have also got a focus on that. Smallholders is becoming a very, very important part of what we do in Syngenta, specifically because they are integral to future food security. If you really look at the future, we will see that large farms or developed farms, they could increase their food productivity by about 20% going ahead in the future, maybe up to 2050. But it's the small farms which are really very, very underproductive. And if you have to achieve those, I think they say there's 10 billion tons of food grain or something required. For that, you require the smallholders' productivity to grow 2.4 times. And that's really something that we need to focus on. What's actually happening is a lot of companies don't give that special focus because it requires investment, it requires a developmental mindset, and it requires a lot of patience. So if you're looking in terms of quick top line growth and quick profitability and quick market share, this is not going to give you that. And that's the reason why we require to have a special focus with, and that's what I'm doing now, which is the food security group. So what exactly do we do in this group? We do projects. We establish business models. What that means is that we look at a specific geography where we see that there is a larger number of smallholders, and it is possible to actually design a project around them. So we identify the geography, we design the model, and we fit in the processes and systems, which are very different from what we do in our normal way of doing business. They cannot be the same processes because there are millions of smallholders, and no company is it possible to actually personally go and interact with all of them. So there has to be a different model for that. We then scale it up, we go to another geography with it, and then another. And then we try to scale it up on a much bigger scale. So this is a long-term kind of process. It involves, for us in the food security group, a very close relationship with our commercial business. Because every step of the way, we work with the commercial business to make things happen. So we have to choose geographies where our commercial business exists. We don't go where it doesn't exist unless we are able to do that with partners. But the commercial business is needed because the product supply and everything depends on that. Just to say that at the end of the day, this is about investment in the beginning, but returns at a later date. So it is not about only investing and being there forever to support the farmer with a lot of expense, but no returns. So I'll come back quickly to the project that I'm going to talk about. We call it Project Nirmiti. Nirmiti is a Hindi word. Nirmiti means creation. So we are creating something new, something different. We chose the eastern part of India to actually do this project because we have a large number of smallholders there. I think a lot of people who have been to India know that the eastern part is much lesser developed than the rest of the country, and the land holdings are very, very small. So it's ideal. We started in a state of Orissa, which is on the eastern coast of India, and there are a lot. The government is pretty open to doing things. There's a lot of civil society presence there. So it's very but the farmer mentality is also very good over there. So it's good to show success, but doesn't mean that we will only look at that. We wanted to show success first. So what does this project do? It actually approaches, there are those points. It has a very developmental and sustainable approach. We use local people over there to help people like them. So it's like local farmers who help other local farmers. And it's not a lead farmer concept where you have a really good farmer who's very good with technology, because those are the farmers who are, like the know-all types, they become, and every company keeps going to so-called lead farmers, and so the lead farmers get better and better. What we thought of doing is that we would go to a similar farmers who would have some degree of education and a little bit of, interest and ambition to do something different, and we would let them help the other farmers. So that means that we create a certain livelihood also, which is in addition to agriculture, for the same farmers. So this basically is the project sort of way, the model. Over here, oops, I'm sorry. Okay, yeah. So here we have Syngenta with our partners, and we have got 5 or 6 companies, and we go to them and we present the project and we get them on board. So these partners, and with along with Syngenta, conduct regular face-to-face trainings with entrepreneurs, or what we call our KTS. We don't like to call them entrepreneurs, frankly, because entrepreneur is a much used word, and an entrepreneur really means, you know, businessman. And we don't want our entrepreneurs to be seen as businessmen at all. So Krishi Tantra Sevak, again in the local language, means farm technology service provider. So they have to be service providers, not sellers. And that's very, very clear. Anybody who starts to behave in a retail, like a retailer, we don't want him to be in the project at all. He has to be a service provider, because service comes first and sales afterwards. So he gets trained by Syngenta and our partners on a regular basis. He goes out there and he trains his farmers. He actually registers them, because he needs to know who they are. He needs to be regularly in touch with them. So it's very important that they register with him. Syngenta has set up what we call a center of excellence. A center of excellence is a place that is actually the home for all the training that we do to the entrepreneurs. It's actually the place from where we provide all the inputs to the entrepreneurs. So every company, Syngenta and its partners, actually keep their material here. And from here, it is transported to the entrepreneurs. So that's really important, because the entrepreneur gets I wouldn't say all at the moment, because there's a lot he needs, but we will make that, we'll increase the number of things we can provide to him. But whatever we have done so far, it's all done through the Center of Excellence. So it's not that he has to run from pillar to post for whatever he needs. And ultimately, there is a benefit to the entrepreneur, there is a benefit to the farmer, and both of them coexist in the same group of villages. And what we have done is about 10 villages to 20 villages per entrepreneur, which is why we need more and more companies to join up, because then there is a chance for the entrepreneur to earn more. And then he's able to build a much better relationship with the farmers. So there is income and productivity for the farmers. There is a relationship. There's a 24/7 presence right in his locality with someone he knows. And that's very, very important long term. So progress has been good. The project is only 2 years old, not even 2 years old, I would say just 2 seasons old, because it took a year to set it up, and it's taken a couple of seasons to test it, and now we are able to now scale it up by going into another state with it. So we have about 40 KTS and we are growing. In fact, the success can be seen from the fact that farmers from different areas, they come to us and they hear about it and they say, I want to do this in my group of 20 villages. And then, of course, we have a very stringent kind of way in which we check whether he's the right person and what is his standing in the community. Do people like him? Do they respect him? And, you know, all the various kind of parameters which are important for him to be a representative for the farmers in his territory. So there are lots of people who are now interested. Going into the future, we plan that by 2015 we should have at least 400 to 500 such KTS in 4 or 5 states of eastern India. The COE is fully functional. We have the processes in place. We have the systems in place. We are able to capture farmers' details. We are able to capture, a lot of the information that we need to be able to provide more services to him. Of course, there's the selling process, the supply process, the pricing process, all of which are very, very important in this model. of course, we're looking at many, many new things. One of them is of course, there's a funding option, because I'm sure a lot of questions would be there, that how does the entrepreneur, the KTS, buy? So we have had certain experiences on that, and I'll be happy to share those. But we are exploring funding options. We are doing a little bit of a pilot of our own with our project money, just to get some kind of a feedback on how the entrepreneur uses the money. Does he return the money on time? How does he multiply the money, etc. So that's something we're doing. We also have developed a tablet application, which is a agronomy cum commercial kind of an application. So that application is being tested with a few KTS, and we'll see how that goes next year. We're also trying out different trainings via cyber cafes, and you know, so that what we need to do is to keep the expenses down. Traveling in the rural areas, traveling with small farmers is a very, very expensive proposition, and that's what does not lead to sustainability of business models. So how do we make sure that we don't have a good big expenditure just to reach to those farmers? We also know that, and that's been my experience personally when I've been in the business, is that farmers use mobile phones a lot, particularly these type of farmers, to talk to other farmers. They don't really use them for getting SMS trainings and stuff like that. So we didn't want to do that, so we do that with the entrepreneur, and the entrepreneur does it directly with the farmers. So that's another thing we're checking and testing. Of course, as I said, we want to increase all of these things, and we want to go to different states. We've already started working in a second state now, parallelly, because the model is working well, and I think it grows in the same state and it parallelly starts to grow in different states. The interesting thing is the commercial business has become very, very interested in what we do, because we are reaching out to those farmers where they don't go. And they can't go, they don't want to go, because it's too expensive for them and the method is not right, which is your retailer distributor method, which doesn't work very much, because these guys also, they get cheated a lot. And that's something that doesn't happen in this model. That's the last slide I have, but the key point that I want to really make over here is that if you really want a self-sustainable model, there has to be a benefit for everyone in that. And that benefit is not only money, it's a lot more. So we need to really understand in different communities what are the needs there. And those needs have to be fulfilled. And you've got to leave behind a model which sort of deals with all of these things. It can't be just left behind. Luckily for Syngenta, Syngenta will be there always through the centers of excellence. But Syngenta will be doing business. The expenses are very clearly managed in a way where the farmer is not paying more. He's not paying less either, because that creates its own problems in the marketplace. So he pays what anybody else would pay, but the benefit of what he's doing is seen by him very, very clearly, and we would not compromise on that. So you have over here, benefit for the corporate partners, brand equity, ability to influence food security, access to new customer segments, and of course the higher market share, which is always desired by companies if they want to prosper. For the KTS, it is a new livelihood in addition to farming. It's knowledge work. They get respected by people in their community. They are representatives of something which is of a group of companies that have a standing in the market, that have respect, and he feels very excited when he participates in this. Of course, there's a direct connect, there is ICT, so he keeps growing personally also, and of course he has an additional income, and there are many very interesting examples of how they have started to think now in terms of how they can do better. I don't know if you can see that, but for most important for the farmers, there's 24/7 support from a trained for kind of source. So it's not 20 companies and telling them 20 things. They get it from one source. There is authentic branded inputs. There is no spurious material over there. It's directly from companies, and this is a very, very important factor because spurious material is a huge problem in India, I'm sure in some of the other developing nations as well. Service at the doorstep. So he's there. You know, he just takes a cycle and he goes to wherever he has to go and help whoever he can help. He sits in his house in the veranda and he talks to farmers when they come there. He has some posters, he gets brochures, he gets books in the local language from us. I'm not to mention his, of course, tablet application. There is transparency in all transactions. The price is one, and that's the price which is shown to the farmer, that this is the price. And then if the retailer puts it at a lower price, the farmer comes to Yelp that, look, this is low. So the entrepreneur says, this is what the company has given me, this is what I'm giving you, like it, fine, don't like it, go to the retailer. But you, the farmer doesn't go because he wants a relationship and he wants that KTS to help him forever. So he rarely goes. He tries, but then he doesn't go. And of course, higher productivity and income for the farmers. And a great deal of benefit is there in that. We want to get into partners who are in the value chain because a lot gets talked about, but we have not done it yet. We need to come to scale a little more, and we also need to be specific about who we would like to involve, and we need to have the right kind of portfolio in terms of the quality of produce if we have to bring them in. So that's a little more complex, but it's on the agenda. Thank you very much for listening in, and any questions, I guess, later.
To learn more about scaling and how you can contribute to this growing body of knowledge, please visit agrilinks.org/scaling.